hey there, I'm Dr. Hagmeyer, and in today's video, I'm going to talk about a very, very important species of bacteria found in the gut microbiome known as Akkermansia. And while it's getting so much attention these days, chances are you probably never heard of this bacteria unless you've recently had a functional stool test that has come back. And when you and your doctor were sitting down reviewing your test results, it was discovered that these Akkermansia levels were very low, or maybe even perhaps they were below the detectable limits. So what does this mean? How did it happen? How do you fix it? Well, stay tuned because that's what this video is all about. I'm going to review all of this and so much more. And if you follow these steps all the way to the end and you implement these different things we're going to be talking about in today's video, I promise you, you're going to be one step closer to a healthy gut. So what is Akkermansia and why should I be so concerned about my low levels? Well, low levels of Akkermansia really is a common finding in people who have gut problems and people that are diabetics and people that have irritable bowel syndrome. Maybe this is someone who's been diagnosed with Crohn's disease or ulcerative colitis or small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. Maybe it's a person with autoimmune disease or a person with leaky gut. Could be somebody who is suffering with insulin resistance or struggling with obesity. So what's so exciting about Akkermansia? Well, this is what's so exciting. Your large intestines is home to a community of microorganisms, bacteria, yeast, fungi, viruses even. Thousands of species of microorganisms are living in your gut. And all of them, while there's some overlap, they do have some different important jobs and roles that they are responsible for keeping your body healthy. You've probably been hearing a lot about the gut barrier and things like a leaky gut, or leaky brain for that matter. But did you know that our gut lining, our gut barrier, it's maintained and reinforced by the very bacteria that I'm talking about today? So if you're excited about talking about a leaky gut like I am, you should be even more excited about talking about these bacteria that play a major pivotal role in maintaining your gut barrier. Akkermansia thrive in the mucus layer of your intestines, but once this mucus layer thins out and it becomes damaged, you have less Akkermansia there that are able to rebuild and maintain that intestinal barrier. So when levels are low on a stool test, this indicates a very big problem. Unfortunately, there's not any one thing you did to cause low levels. But here's the thing I will tell you. I'm seeing this more and more often with my patients who've been diagnosed with irritable bowel syndrome, diagnosed with inflammatory bowel disease, diagnosed with diabetes. Many of them are struggling with stomach pain and abdominal pain and constipation and diarrhea and chronic bloating. They've been on keto diets. They've been on low FODMAP diets. They're on low histamine diets. And their diet, unfortunately, is becoming more and more restrictive of what they can and they can't eat. And it's almost impossible to tell what's caused by food and what's being caused by the actual state of disorganization of their gut. I say this only because in the last few weeks, I've had a handful of new patients who've come to me not being able to really eat much of anything after being on a keto or carnivore diet. And I've had one patient was on a low FODMAP diet for over 18 months, and it's now becoming impossible to try to introduce new foods without a reaction. And this is a consequence of really what we're seeing more and more patients, happening to more and more patients because they're on these diets. Essentially, what many have done unintentionally is you're eating basically a high fat, high protein diet, low carb, low fiber, and low polyphenols. You've created this perfect storm to really snuff out your Akkermansia, really just wipe out those levels of short chain fatty acids. But that's not the only thing that causes low levels of short chain fatty acids and low levels of Akkermansia. High dietary fats will do that. Low carbs will do that. And we can also thank medications like antibiotics and antidepressants. So again, low fiber, low in vegetables, low fruits, low polyphenols, and high alcohol consumption really are some of the reasons why these bacteria, they no longer want to be a part of your microbiome. So let's figure out how to improve them. Let's talk about this gut barrier for just a moment and Akkermansia. Your gastrointestinal tract is continuously being exposed to disease-causing pathogens. Every mouthful of food that you take, you're exposing your immune system to millions and millions of bacteria. And your GI tract is one of the major entry points for these pathogens, right? Now, luckily, our bodies are intelligently designed to deal with this constant threat and this bombardment of these pathogens. If we look at this illustration, we can see that the gut lining really is made up of a single layer of epithelial cells that form one continuous cell sheet interconnected with what are known as tight junctions. Now, sitting on the top of all this is a nice layer of mucus. That mucus layer is rich in protein called mucin. And mucin creates a gel coating. Not only does this mucus layer provide a physical barrier to pathogens, but it's loaded with all kinds of immune system fighting cells that really protect your body. When you hear doctors and researchers and nutritionists make the statement that 90% of your immune system is in your gut, well, this is where that 90% of your immune system is. This is what we're talking about. Just underneath that mucus layer sits the gut barrier. And when it comes to the gut barrier, its main function is to allow useful substances like nutrients and electrolytes to enter the body, and it blocks opportunistic microbes and their toxins from getting into our bloodstream, making us sick and trying to make you die. So what you need to remember is this mucus lining forms a physical barrier stopping bad bacteria and other disease-causing pathogens from causing chronic inflammation and breaking down this gut bacteria, this gut barrier, leading to this leaky gut. Now, Akkermansia happily live in this mucus layer. They eat and they munch on these mucins all day long. And in turn, they produce short-chain fatty acids like acetate and propionate. If and when the mucus layer is disturbed, it will lead to a breakdown in those tight junctions. It will lead to a leaky gut and will increase the risk of infection and inflammation and chronic disease and metabolic disorders and insulin resistance and problems with your immune system. So short-chain fatty acids are one of the key benefits to a healthy gut microbiome. Not that long ago, I did a video titled, How to Improve Your Gut Health by Increasing Short-Chain Fatty Acids. So if you don't know what those are, just as a quick review, you can always go back and watch that video. But just as a quick refresher, if you want better gut health, you need to get your short-chain fatty acid levels up, and you need to get your Akkermansia levels up. There are three major types of short-chain fatty acids that we measure when we run a functional stool test. Now, these short-chain fatty acids have names like acetate and propionate and butyrate. And these are produced when bacteria eat fiber, or in this case, when they eat mucins. The short-chain fatty acids have many health benefits. They're anti-inflammatory, they're immunoregulatory, they're anti-obesity, they're anti-diabetes, they're anti-cancer. They protect your heart, they protect your liver, they protect your nerve system. So one of the keys to rebuilding your gut health is improving the level of short-chain fatty acids. And you do this by increasing your Akkermansia levels. Now remember, one of the ways you wipe out your short-chain fatty acids is with high fat, low carb, low polyphenol, low fiber foods. Now let's talk about some of the foods and some of the supplements that help encourage the growth of Akkermansia. I'm going to talk about these kind of together because if you have low levels, you really should be not only eating more of these foods from a dietary standpoint, but you should also be supplementing them with obviously different supplements we're going to be mentioning here in just a moment that contain higher therapeutic dosages of these as well. So polyphenols, right? These are plant-based compounds that protect your body, help your fight infection and fight disease, and they support immunity. Polyphenols are things like berries, fresh herbs, cranberry juice, cocoa. Specifically, the polyphenols that have been shown to increase Akkermansia levels are the kinds that you find in cranberries and green tea and pomegranate extract, grape polyphenols, rhubarb extract, okay? Next on the list is fructooligosaccharides, or FOS. These are plant sugars that occur in fruits and vegetables, things like onion, chicory, garlic, asparagus, banana, artichoke. These again are prebiotics, right? Because they do not get digested until they reach the colon. And in the colon, they're then digested by good bacteria. This helps the good bacteria grow, which is why they are used as prebiotics. They're a food for probiotics, again, for your good bacteria. So those are prebiotic supplements, but research also shows us that there are certain strains of probiotics that are helpful to increase Akkermansia levels as well. These are going to be things like Lactobacillus rhamnosus species, as well as Bifidobacterium species. Lactobacillus plantarum is another one. Next on my list are amino acids like threonine, serine, proline, and cysteine. These, again, are all helping promote mucin synthesis. Again, that's the mucus layer, those sugar proteins, those glycoproteins that Akkermansia feed on. Healthy fats, a diet rich with fish oil and flaxseed oil and olives, have all been shown to increase levels of Akkermansia. Recent studies show that omega-3 fats, particularly EPA, are associated with larger gut microbiome diversity, lower inflammation, and higher levels of Akkermansia. Again, all designed to help encourage growth. So there you go. If you have questions about becoming a patient, or you have a functional stool test and you need help interpreting it, or you need help getting a functional stool test, reach out to my clinic. And if you like today's video, I recommend that you watch this video that you see right here next.